بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم. Hello everybody. I am truly humbled with opportunity to moderate this webinar. Special thanks for Prof. Saad Mahdi for inviting me in this activity. It's my great pleasure and honor to be with you in this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome in Mega Medical Academy course. Here is a quick review about Mega Medical Academy course. It's arranged by Prof. Saad Mahdi with truly impressive preparation effort, holding in collaboration with international speaker. It is non-profit educational program, which designed to help medical staff, particularly anesthesiologists and intensive care physician, to share our knowledge, our experience, and update recommendation, and to give us insight that empower us and help us in our career. I am glad to tell you that also this course is approved and recognized by College of Anesthesiologists in Ireland, plus Egyptian Society of Anesthesiologists and Egyptian Institute for Compulsory Medical Education. And just to point your attention, the whole session will be recorded as a video and will be displayed in YouTube channel named Mega Medical Academy 1. And it will be shared as a link in Facebook and Mega Medical group. Okay, so me honestly, I thought it will be very helpful to share it with your colleague, resident, fellow, so we can get a maximum benefit from all the information and lecture has been posted before. Quickly, before we move to our speaker, let me introduce our second moderator, Prof. Muhammad Hamdi. He's my teacher and role model as well. I have a humble experience to work with him during my training program. Prof. Muhammad Hamdi, he's lecturer of anesthesia in Ain Shams University, and currently he is a consultant in King Abdullah Medical City. Welcome, Dr. Muhammad. Mic is yours, and you can proceed. I forget to introduce you.
Thank you too much. I will introduce you.
Okay.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah wa salatu wa salam ala rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Welcome everyone. Welcome my colleague. I hope all of you happy and well. Thanks too much, Dr. Wafa. I will introduce you. Dr. Wafa, mashallah, anesthesia consultant and head of anesthesia department in King Faisal Hospital. And really, it's a great honor that we are working together. Again, I'm Dr. Muhammad Hamdi, lecturer of anesthesia in Shams University and anesthesia consultant, King Abdullah Medical City, Saudi Arabia, Makkah al-Mukarrama. I want to express my deep thanks for Prof. Mahdi for his endless effort to keep conduct of this mega online course. So too much thanks, Prof. Mahdi, for your effort. And also, really, I'm very happy and I'm very proud to be between all of this excellent, eminent, prestigious professor and speakers today. Our course today, our session today, it will be, inshallah, three very interesting topics. The first topic will be the Addisonian Crisis Management in ICU. Second topic will be perioperative management of a patient for renal or kidney transplant. And the last topic will be perioperative management of a patient with renal failure. So, to save time, let's welcome the first speaker today. Actually, the first speaker is one of the eminent name and one of the figures in critical care medicine, Prof. Elansary. Prof. Samir Ansari is a prof of anesthesia and critical care in Ain Shams University. And I think my word cannot express the value and the caliber of Prof. Ansari. All of us learned from his endless knowledge and science. So I'm sure that all of us today will enjoy for his interesting topic. So please, Prof. Ansari, go on, all of us waiting you to talk about the Addisonian crisis management in ICU. Please go on.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Good
Good evening, my colleague. Good evening, our attendees. Before I start, thanks Dr. Mohammed Hamdi for, and Dr. Ofa for this nice and modified introduction. Really very nice. Today, I am going to speak about important point in ICU, which we must not miss while we are managed our critically ill patient and septic patient, especially if they are showing refractory hypotension, not responding to IV fluid and other resuscitation maneuver like vasopressors and so on. And through a discussion of two cases, I think I will highlight the topic, which, as you know, all of you know the topic, which is the Addisonian crisis. We have one patient, 19 years old, female, with a history of Hashimoto's thyroiditis, diagnosed several years prior. She had been taking levothyroxine, 25 microgram only. Presented to ICU following witness sudden cardiac arrest and successful CPR with defibrillation and ER. Per family, the patient had occasionally complained of fatigue, nausea, vomiting, confusion, psychosis, slurred speech, and ticker. These symptoms is specific for Addisonian crisis or adrenal deficiency. Fatigue, nausea, vomiting, confusion, psychosis, slurred speech, severe lethargy, but had unintentionally lost about 25 kilograms in the previous year. Also, loss of weight is a characteristic symptom. She apparently craved for salt and lemon juice because, as you know, most of those patients suffering from low sodium hyponatremia. Her only medication was levothyroxine, 25 microgram daily. She had not been taking any over-the-counter supplement, oral contraceptive, or any natural medicine. We have to ask the patient if he take any medications which may suppress the adrenal gland, like etomidate, like some antifungal, and so on.
Dr. Samir?
Yes?
Can you please share your screen?
I'm not sharing them.
Oh. Yes, please.
I'm sharing already my screen. Is the slide not appearing to you?
No, it is shared, Prof. It is okay. Thank you.
Okay. An initial computed tomography scan of her head was normal. Subsequent magnetic resonance imaging of the brain show cortical gyroform diffusion restriction involving the parietal and the occipital lobes consistent with an anoxic brain injury. And always we depend on MRI for better evaluation of brain situation, especially after cardiac arrest or after hypoglycemia or after any global insult to the brain. Better to depend on MRI. On examination, she was hypotensive, with systolic blood pressure in the 70s. And pulse in the 150 tachycardic, temperature slightly febrile. She was intubated, had cool extremities, and exhibited generalized hyperpigmentation and the tanning of her skin creases. As you know, in Addisonian, in which there is a hyperpigmentation due to melanocyte stimulating hormone associated increased secretion of it, increases the pigmentation. And so it characterizes the primary Addisonian crisis from the secondary Addisonian crisis. Her pupils were dilated 5 to 7 millimeter and poorly reactive. Lab data show low sodium level, 129, as a normal up from 135, hyponatremic, potassium level slightly high, 5.6, and low blood glucose and the high white cell count. Also, the Addisonian patients suffering from hyponatremia due to aldosterone deficiency. As you know, aldosterone action is retention of sodium and the excretion of potassium. In such a situation here, the patient is hyponatremic and hyperkalemic. And this is characteristic also of low aldosterone. Low blood glucose level, hypoglycemia is also one of the manifestations of adrenal deficiency, and the high white cell count, especially eosinophils. Cardiac troponin started to be high and reached 2.88 nanogram per ml. Creatinine kinase also is, and myocardial B-protein is also elevated. A urine drug screen was negative. Lactate level, of course, the patient is hypotensive, and so we're initially high, but normalized quickly with intravenous hydration. And as you know, we depend on serum lactate as a prognostic marker for resuscitation. This patient started to take IV fluid, and so lactate level due to hypoperfusion started to be decreased. A chest CT show diffused pulmonary capacity concerning for aspiration. Always any patient on ventilator, take care of aspiration. And if you find chest problems after intubation, suspect may be aspiration pneumonia or ventilator associated pneumonia. She was started on broad spectrum antibiotics. A transthoracic echo shows severe dilatation of left ventricle and global hypokinesia and low ejection fraction less than 25 of both left ventricle and right ventricle. Her hemodynamic changes were significant for a low cardiac index of 2.3 liter per minute, which is low, and so associated with elevated vascular resistance of 1,800 dynes second centimeter bar 5, and elevated pulmonary artery pressure of 33 millimeter mercury. As you know, the normal is about. Her central venous pressure CVP was also elevated 11 millimeter mercury. And so we exclude now the hypovolemia as a cause of severe hypotension. Her blood pressure was consistent low despite being on multiple vasopressors, inotrope, intravenous hydration, extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, intra-aortic balloon pump, imidazoline, and prophylactic antibiotics. All these, as you know, the methods of resuscitation of hypotensive patients or refractory hypertension. Lab work including blood and urine culture and was revealing no positive cultures. An electroencephalogram was consistent with generalized encephalopathy, and it confirms the MRI finding. An electrocardiogram show sinus tachycardia with no STT changes. To further evaluate her vasopressor resistance in such situations, and this is a message today which I want to send to everyone. In cases of refractory hypotension, you have to think in estimation of cortisol level or early morning cortisol, and so it is checked in this patient and was undetected. Her free thyroxine was 0.59 nanogram, which is low per liter, and also her thyroid stimulating hormone was elevated. As you know, she's suffering from hypothyroidism. She was started on hydrocortisone 100 milligram every 6 hours. Her levothyroxine dose increased to 50 microgram daily, and we detect anti-thyroid peroxidase antibody titer, which was very high, 1,000 units per ml. The normal is less than 100 units per ml, and so we suspect maybe autoimmune thyroiditis and associated with autoimmune adrenal disease. Subsequent adrenal corticotrophic hormone, ACTH, level was drawn, which was very high, 1,708, and this confirmed the primary adrenal deficiency or Addisonian crisis. Normal level, as you know, 0 to 45 picogram per ml. With serum sodium hyponatremic, and she had undetectable aldosterone, sodium is low, but potassium is slightly high, and then elevated renal level to about 61 nanogram per ml. Anti-adrenal antibody also were detected, and so the diagnosis is autoimmune origin, which causes Addisonian disease or Addisonian crisis. We make CTD, CT, non-contrast CT scan, of course, must be done on the abdomen and the pelvis to see or evaluate the adrenal, if there is any hemorrhage, any tuberculosis, any infection, and so on, or metastasis in the adrenal. We unrevealing, and the adrenal gland appear normal. And so the cause here is the underlying cause in this situation, in this case, is an autoimmune adrenal effect. Her clinical status and hemodynamics greatly improved after hydrocortisone. Steroid were after that weaned to physiological doses of hydrocortisone, 10 milligram in the morning, 5 milligram in the evening, and fludrocortisone 0.05 milligram daily was added. Most of the patients may need fludrocortisone supplementation, and the most of the patients really in such situation need long life cortisone replacement therapy. With the physiological doses given daily, which is 10 milligram morning, 5 milligram in the evening, or 3 doses per day. And we have, in such a situation, pushing the patient to make cortisol level every now and then, and for confirming if she is still suffering from low, from deficiency state, or from hypoadrenal. An echocardiogram show normal ejection fraction more than 55% and normal right ventricle, left ventricle after steroid therapy. She underwent rehabilitation and made full recovery. The possibility of having autoimmune polyglandular syndrome type 2, type 2 syndrome, polyglandular syndrome associated, of course, with thyroid deficiency or thyroid autoimmune disease. Addisons plus thyroid. Type 1. Polyglandular autoimmune is associated with hypoparathyroidism and also mucocutaneous fungus infection. We accumulated the hemoglobin glucosated the hemoglobin was lower A1C was checked and was low normal level 4.7%. And so the patient not suffering from diabetes mellitus. And as you know, the glycosylated hemoglobin is done every 2 months, 3 months, parallel the lifespan of RBCs. And so give us an indirect picture or indirect index of the level of glucose in the previous time of 2 months or 3 months. Primary adrenal insufficiency or Addison disease has many causes, the most common being autoimmune adrenalitis, which results from destruction of adrenal cortex, leading to deficiency of glucocorticoids from the adrenal fasciculata and the mineralocorticoids and adrenal androgens. Cortisol can act either directly or indirectly on the peripheral vessels and the heart tissue by potentiation of vasoactive factor. And so it has a potentiating effect on vasopressors. Without cortisol, the vasopressor effect is negligible or not efficient. Aldosterone has also been implicated as a direct regulator of cardiac extracellular matrix and collagen dosage. Although an excess of this hormone is associated with cardiac abnormalities in the form of myocardial hypertrophy and dysfunction. Also, its deficiency of corticosteroids lead to cardiac abnormality due to endogenous catecholamine effect on the heart. Cardiac failure has been described as a coexisting illness in adrenal insufficiency. Profound hypotension has been shown to be refractory to catecholamine because it is also associated with secondary volume depletion due to adrenal failure. And so in patients with severe sepsis or patients subjected to stress or trauma in your ICU and the exhibited or cardiac failure and the exhibited or exhibiting refractory hypertension, you have to think in adrenal deficiency in such situations. The myocardial dysfunctions and severe hypotension may lead to fatal course if underlying adrenal insufficiency is not diagnosed, of course. And glucocorticoid treatment rapidly improves the situations and saves the life of the patient. also glucocorticoid deficiency may down-regulate the expression of adrenergic receptors and the response of adrenergic receptors to catecholamine. And so it's very important for the proper action of catecholamine. Also, it is hypothesized that glucocorticoid deficiency may result in loss of protective effect against catecholamine, against catecholamine, endogenous catecholamine on the heart muscle. Cardiac failure leading to death is well recognized as a major problem in adrenal crisis. There are several hypothesis mechanisms to explain the cause of this cardiac failure. In our patient, of course, we can conclude that he is suffering from many problems consequent to adrenal deficiency. He's suffering from hyponatremia, suffering from hyperkalemia, started to suffer, of course, maybe some acidosis in such situations. The patient was at first was hypovolemic. All this may predispose to cardiac failure, and this factor may coincide and potentiate the failure of the patient. And just we started the corticosteroids, the patient exhibiting improvement. Hypovolemia resulting from mineralocorticoid deficiency alone seems insufficient to explain the sudden profound cardiovascular collapse in our patient, as her CVV, as I told first, was elevated about 11 millimeter mercury. But it is a factor, very important factor in other situations and on other patients suffering from adrenal deficiency. We have to think in hypovolemic state. Electrolyte abnormality also may be not so factor, but also we have to consider if some patients, we can see some patients suffering from severe hyponatremia and hyperkalemia. Sympathectomy and the alpha beta blockade have been shown to protect stressed adrenalectomized animals from circulatory failure. And so, glucocorticoids, as I said, have a protective effect on the cardiac muscles from the bad effects of catecholamine. This blockade helps the otherwise detrimental effect of catecholamine on the heart and the blood vessels in the absence of glucocorticoids. Also, stress can precipitate adrenal crisis in adrenalectomized animals before any change in serum electrolyte occurs. And so serum electrolyte changes in adrenal deficiency is not so an important factor in affecting the cardiac muscle and the hypertension. It may be late. Our patient CVV was elevated, and so hypovolemia is not an explaining for such situation. Reversible myocardial dysfunction can occur in the setting of critical illness, as in stressful states such as sepsis, acute respiratory failure, or trauma if we start glucocorticoids. Literature suggests that an autoimmune-mediated phenomenon may present as a dilated cardiomyopathy in some patients. And these are the pictures of the echo before and after steroids. As you see, the ejection fraction improved here, right, and even the volume of right ventricle and left ventricle is increased. Conclusions due to the non-specific symptoms on presentation, primary adrenal insufficiency can pose a challenge to diagnosis. And although the presentations of cardiogenic shock in patients with undiagnosed adrenal insufficiency is considered a rarity, we have to think in it, and we have to consider and initiating stress dose of steroids even before proceeding to cortisone test or for estimating the cortisol level. Adrenal insufficiency usually present with vague symptoms such as weakness, fatigue, anorexia, weight loss, hyperpigmentation in primary Addisonian, as a primary symptoms. Acute adrenal crisis can manifest with vomiting, abdominal pain, and hypovolemic shock. Cardiogenic shock arising from adrenal insufficiency is less common. Just we describe this case to simplify and clarify the consequence of adrenal insufficiency. Addisonian disease, again, what is the symptoms? Prone pigmentation of the skin in primary hypoadrenalism. Changes in distribution of body hair and gastrointestinal disturbance, nausea, vomiting, and weakness, muscle weakness, weight loss, hypoglycemia in some patients, and loss of hypotension, and profound fatigue, dehydration, vascular collapse, decreased blood pressure, renal shutdown. and decrease the sodium and increase the potassium. As you know, aldosterone action is retention of sodium and excretion of potassium. Hyperpigmentation here, as we see, and especially darkening of the gums due to increased pigment, as seen there, because it is associated with increased ACTH secretions, increased melanocyte stimulating hormone, and so leads to hyperpigmentation in primary adrenal deficiency. And remember, always the cycle of cortisone secretions, so first from controlling from hypothalamus through its sensors to cytokines and to acetylcholine, and they release corticotrophic hormone, which stimulates the pituitary, and pituitary secrete ACTH to activate the adrenal cortex secreting glucocorticoids, which has a negative feedback mechanism suppressing the secretion of corticotrophic hormone and ACTH. And so don't forget the pigmentation, hyperpigmentation in such situations of those patients who are suffering from adrenal insufficiency. And you have to be oriented with the difference between hypofunction of adrenal gland, Addisonian disease, and the other hyperfunction or hypersecretions of adrenal cortex, even with Cohn's syndrome, with hyperaldosteronism. And in such situations, the electrolytes differ from hypo to hyper. In hypoadrenal functions, or in Addisonian, we have hypotension, hyponatremia, and increased potassium, as in our case report, in contrast to Cushing, which exhibiting high aldosterone level, and so high sodium and low potassium, in addition to other manifestation which is characteristic to Cushing disease, as hyperglycemia, as hypertension, as skin manifestations, all these, and depression, and all these manifestations. I will proceed to another case report which clarify more the adrenal deficiency with other causes affecting the adrenal gland and leading to adrenal deficiency, especially in our ICU. As you know, most of the patients suffering from critical illness, and they are under anticoagulant treatment, and so the possibility of hemorrhage in any site of the body, especially adrenal gland, which lead to Waterhouse-Fredrickson syndrome, which is adrenal hemorrhage and lead to adrenal deficiency. So adrenal hemorrhage is one of the common causes of adrenal deficiency in ICU, and so must be oriented with this. We have a 76 years old lady who was admitted to hospital when she was discovered to have severe anemia, hemoglobin level 6, 61 gram per liter, packed cell volume low, and while she was taking anticoagulant therapy, prothrombin ratio very high, 3.7. She had a 4-week history of non-specific left-sided abdominal pain, nausea, reduced appetite, passing dark stools, and breathlessness on exertion. Patient was given 10 milligrams of vitamin K to correct the INR, of course, and I think we get fresh frozen plasma, and 2 units of back cell blood transfusion, followed by an endoscopy done, which didn't show or reveal any source of upper gastrointestinal bleeding or abnormality. 4 days later, while the patient, an inpatient, she became acutely confused, unwell with symptoms and signs of chest infection, including fever, severe hypotension, which didn't respond to intravenous antibiotic and intravenous fluid. Patient's past medical history consists of hypothyroidism, for which she takes levothyroxine 125 microgram daily, and systemic lupus erythematosus, for which she took warfarin tablet 3 milligram daily for previous cranial vasculitis and the thromboembolic episodes. As you know, antiphospholipid syndrome patients always we give anticoagulant to protect the patient from thromboembolic complications, which develop as a consequence of vasculitis and so on. And so this patient we see, she's suffering from hypothyroidism, suffering from systemic lupus erythematosus or antiphospholipid, and all these can be, and she under treatment with anticoagulant, which is common in ICU due to other causes. which causes some sort of adrenal hemorrhage. And so we must record and we must be cautious of anticoagulant to avoid this side effect. She had been tried on hydroxychloroquine in the past, but this was stopped because of visual side effect, and her systemic lupus was under control. As you know, we give always hydroxychloroquine in autoimmune diseases to modulate the autoimmune state and controlling the disease. Apart from that, the patient was usually fat and well. There was no past history of prolonged high-dose corticosteroid use, which is one of the causes of adrenal deficiency. If the patient was on steroid before and stopped this steroid, even since a few months. But she had received a short course prednisone 10 milligrams daily for 1 week, 2 years prior to this presentation. So I think this is not a causing of adrenal deficiency. On the day of admission, she was pale, had mild tenderness in her left iliac fossa on abdomen examination. Rectal exam didn't reveal any source of bleeding. Repeat exam demonstrated heart rate of 98 per minute, blood pressure 75 over 50, hypotensive. She had temperature of 38 febrile and breathes 18 breathes per minute. Oxygen saturation 95 on room air. Always when you say saturation, you have to mention how much this patient on oxygen, room air, or is she receiving supplemental oxygen. Chest exam revealed dull nodes and inspiratory crackles on both phases. Abdominal exam revealed no abnormal findings. Investigation routine blood tests demonstrate features or in keeping with infection, raised C-reactive protein, thrombocytopenia, and raised D-dimer. And I want to stress here, C-reactive protein, not indicator of infection. It is indicating of inflammation in general, not specific for infection. Thrombocytopenia and raised D-dimer. The coagulation profile indicated mild anticoagulant due to warfarin and the initial raised prostaglandin time ratio corrected with vitamin K. Arterial blood gas sample demonstrated type 1 respiratory impairment. Blood cultures didn't yield any organism, but a urine culture yielded clinically significant urine tract infection with Enterococcus faecalis bacteria and is sensitive to amoxicillin and nitrofurantoin. These lab investigations for this patient after becoming confused and hypotensive, and as we see, your white blood cells started to go up, hemoglobin is very low, eosinophilic count is high, and this is specific for adrenal deficiency. Platelet count thrombocytopenic 91, activated prothrombin time ratio as you call, 3.7, very high, D-dimer high. Sodium is low, 126, but not manifesting or not giving the signs of hyponatremia. All of the signs of hyponatremia start when the patient exerting sodium below 120, start to be confused, the CNS manifestations and so on. Potassium is slightly high, creatinine is normal, normal, 74. Urea also is in the normal range, C-reactive protein high. Cortisol level is very low. 9 AM cortisol is 23 nanomole per liter, which is very low. Alkaline phosphatase also slightly high. Bilirubin normal, albumin is slightly low. Most of our patients in ICU, when you make albumin due to stress and inflammation, and they are exhibiting the hypoalbumin. Alanine transferase is normal, amylase, all the other investigation. Chest X-ray, as you see, show pulmonary basal infiltrates, both sides. If we look to the CT here, we see the adrenal gland is hazy and a large shadow which manifests adrenal hemorrhage. And this CT is specific for adrenal, which give us this picture, in this case, hypoadrenalism or Addisonian crisis due to treatment with anticoagulant. And so in your patient, in ICU, when they're accepting refractory hypotension, and the patient under treatment with anticoagulant, we have to sinking in adrenal hemorrhage. Don't forget this point, very important really. Also, in patients with antiphospholipid syndrome may manifest other manifestation of autoimmune disease, maybe autoimmune adrenal dysfunction. Treatment, intravenous antibiotic and fluid resuscitation for sepsis, and always remember in septic patients, especially with meningococcal septicemia, the patient is liable to exhibiting adrenal hemorrhage and adrenal dysfunction or hypofunction. Started in intravenous hydrocortisone, and after that, after 100 milligram, given 50 milligram four times per day, and after that, the patient taking 20 milligram daily, 10 milligram in the morning, 5 milligram a day, and 5 milligram in the evening, and started to, and even after the charge, she continued in this maintenance physiological dose of hydrocortisone. Some patients need fludrocortisone also and still suffering from hypotension. And if you start the fludrocortisone, which is a mineralocorticoid, 100 microgram or 50 microgram daily, was added for mineralocorticoid replacement, the blood pressure will improve. The anticoagulant medication, warfarin, was stopped and the patient stayed in hospital for 14 days and improved after that and discharged with steroid, very important, with a steroid identification card and an intramuscular steroid kit for emergency use. Those patients need to keep with them standby dose, either intramuscular or intravenous steroid kit to be given during any stress. Otherwise, she will collapse at any stress situation, infection, trauma, psychic trauma, and this CT is done after, I think, 1 year, and you see it exhibiting improvement of the hemorrhage is subsiding or resolving. But the patient is still under ACTH stimulation test or Cuisinetrope stimulation test, she exhibiting manifest hypoadrenal functions and still in need for the physiological doses of steroids. And so if you make CT and you find your CT is normal, you have to make also the steroid function test to see if the adrenal gland retaining its function and secreting steroid in the normal manner or not. So follow up short senexine test done at 10 months and another 2 years after presentation confirmed ongoing adrenal insufficiency and so still suffering from adrenal insufficiency and needing physiological doses of steroid to be taken daily. As you know, the test is easy and it is done a random cortisol assay performed on a morning blood sample revealed severe hypocortisolemia, serum cortisol of 23 nanomole per liter, in the presence of severe physiological stress and sepsis. And so this is the test, the result of the test of this of these patients. At 0 minute after giving the dose of ACTH or synthetic ACTH, which is cosinotropin, she only, her cortisol level 31 nanomole per liter. The normal is 250 to 600, and I think this value differ from textbook to other, but in normally mostly in this range. After 30 minutes, it is also very low, 30 nanomole per liter. So the normal is more than 550 nanomole per liter. 2 years after that, but still suffering from decreasing secretions of steroid or cortisol. Sepsis associated with adrenal hemorrhage is considered an uncommon cause of adrenal insufficiency during acute critical illness. A post-mortem exam reveals the incidence about 1.1% in patients treated for sepsis. Most, this is the percentage, but although it is a low percentage, but it is very important to be considered in ICU. Bleeding within the adrenal cortex, of course, causes compression and affect all the secreted steroid, glucocorticoid, mineralocorticoid, and adrenal androgens. In male androgens, it's not so important because it is secreted by the testicles also. But in female, it will decrease, of course, the libido and more be affected or more manifested by this in this situation. Bacterial infection has repeatedly been implicated as an important contributor in etiology of spontaneous adrenal hemorrhage. Coagulopathy, very important, especially DIC, is a recognized complication of severe sepsis and may be a good important factor in causing adrenal hemorrhage. Adrenal hemorrhage, of course, liable in why it is especially occur in the adrenal gland more commonly because the adrenal gland is supplied arterial supply from three arteries, from the aorta and from the renal artery and from the inferior phrenic artery. And so there is a hyperdynamic circulation, especially in sepsis. But the venous drainage is only through one vein to the inferior vena cava. And so it is more liable to bleeding. Systemic lupus erythematosus or antiphospholipid antibody syndrome remains a risk factor for development of adrenal hemorrhage, as was with this case and several reported other cases. The passages is unclear, but there is a hypothesis that the adrenal gland is rich in cholesterol-containing tissue. And so the antiphospholipid antibody, which are exaggerated here or concentrated high in antiphospholipid syndrome, may be attracted and cause both hemorrhage and thrombotic destruction of the adrenal gland. Anticoagulant therapy and the heparin-induced thrombocytopenia are risk factor for development of bilateral adrenal hemorrhage. Therefore, important of close monitoring of anticoagulant therapy during sepsis can't be overemphasized. Very important, as you know, as we told, the lab investigations typically show hyponatremia, hyperkalemia, leukocytosis, eosinophilia, and anemia in such situations. CT scan, very important to exclude malignancy, to exclude other causes of adrenal hyperfunctions like tuberculosis, like fungal infections, metastasis, all causes. Also, adrenal failure would have been exacerbated by sepsis, and this patient, as we know, suffering from pneumonia and urinary tract infection. In severely ill patients suspected of having adrenal insufficiency, a stimulated increment in cortisol level below 248 after administration of 250 micrograms of quinidine or senectin, which is artificial ACTH, is diagnostic of Addisonian crisis. And this is a simple test, and then maybe we have short test and long test, and I think the short test is enough. And no contraindication to start your treatment by steroid if you suspect such situations. And after taking the sample, you give a steroid dose, which is 100 hydrocortisone, and followed by 50 three times every day. And after that, you can proceed to the test. And you can give also dexamethasone in such situations, not interfering with the test. CT, don't forget, forget CT. It is very important for diagnosis of such. And don't forget the symptoms, which are characteristic to Addisonian: severe nausea, vomiting, hypoglycemia, confusion, psychosis, slurred speech, lethargy, hyponatremia, hyperkalemia, hypercalcemia, convulsions, fever. All these are manifestations of Addisonian disease. The presence of Addisonian, as I told, if present with hypoparathyroidism and mucocutaneous candidiasis, it is a type 1 polyendocrine syndrome. If it is associated with thyroid dysfunction or hypofunction, it is type 2 polyglandular syndrome. Causes of adrenal or Addisonian: adrenal destructions by or adrenoleukodystrophy, metastasis, hemorrhage, antiphospholipid syndrome, particular infections like tuberculosis, coccidioidomycosis, in cases of amyloidosis, at the deposition of abnormal protein, all these causes the syndrome. Also, some drugs as hormone by liver, they as rifampicin and phenytoin may exaggerate the destruction of the hormones. Impaired stereogenesis to form cortisol in the adrenal gland if the patient is suffering from hypocholesterol, if the cholesterol is low, because cholesterol is essential here. Interruptions in the delivery of cholesterol include Smith-Lemli-Opitz syndrome and a beta-lipoproteinemia. All these can cause Addisonian crisis, and so many causes. But the important causes in our ICU, which are related to intensivist, really is severe infection, bacterial infection, especially meningococcal infection, and also the coagulopathy and the anticoagulant use and DIC. Routine lab investigations may show low blood sugar again, hypoglycemia, low blood sodium, increased potassium, aldosterone may be low, high blood potassium, eosinophilia, lymphocytosis, metabolic acidosis, because as you know, aldosterone, when it is deficient, there is a decrease in sodium, and so hydrogen is retained in the body because the sodium hydrogen bond is impaired or restricted. Seeing in this picture, the pathway of stimulation of the adrenal cortex from hypothalamus, the corticotrophic hormones, pituitary gland after that, ACTH with melanocyte stimulating hormone affect adrenal cortex releasing steroids. In suspected cases, we can go directly to ACTH stimulation or synaxine test. Dexamethasone, as I told before, could be given in such situations or during the performing the cosentropin stimulation test. In secondary adrenal insufficiency, of course, due to pituitary disorders, which is not our topic today. We can proceed to making insulin tolerance test and corticotropin releasing hormone estimations for deciding or for localizing exactly the cause of Addisonian, if it is primary or secondary or tertiary from the hypothalamic causes and so on. Also, aldosterone stimulations we can detect through ACTH stimulation. We can estimate the aldosterone level, and if it is low, we can substitute with sodium. Treatment, of course, fluids and prednisone, hydrocortisone tablets or prednisone tablets, fludrocortisone in some patients if they need or if they still exist in resistant hypertension. And don't forget to inform the patients and teach the patient and push the patient to carry an emergency dose of steroid for resuscitation himself in any stress situations. I hope to be benefit from these lectures, and I think we have to stop here. Thank you and good luck.
Prof. Elansary, thank you for this very illustrative and excellent and concentrated. We have some question, Prof. Elansary. Did you hear me?
Yes, Prof. your Ansari. Voice is clear, Dr. Muhammad. Thank you.
Yes, if you again, thanks, Dr. Elansary, Prof. Elansary, for this very illustrative, excellent, very concentrated lecture. We have one question here from Dr. Muhammad Abdussalam Manchawi. He's one of my colleague, lecturer of anesthesia and Champs University. He's asking about the causes of adrenal hemorrhage.
Mostly if the patient, as I told, may suffering from coagulopathy or under large dose of anticoagulant or suffering from other causes of vasculitis like antiphospholipid syndrome as lupus or other autoimmune diseases. This is the most common, or maybe metastasis in the adrenal gland. This is the most common. And any patient is starting to exhibiting high indices of coagulation profile like INR or BT or BTT, you can suspect such situations.
Yes, Prof. One question more about the Friedreich's syndrome. Friedreich's syndrome or adrenal gland hemorrhage, always, Prof. Elansary, it is irreversible one. Yeah, and once happened, make it totally destruction and patient need.
No, it can be. This case report is improved after that, and the hemorrhage is resolved. But sure. The patient really, in most of the patients, they exhibiting a hypo function of the adrenal gland.
But for longer time, Prof?
Yes, not permanent replacement, sir. But so some patients regain function.
Sure. And so it could be reversible.
So in such a situation, not depending on only on CT follow-up, you have to depend on performing cortisone function test.
Yes. One question more about Prof. Elansary, you mentioned one of manifestation of adrenal insufficiency, renal shutdown. The mechanism and what is the presentation of renal shutdown?
And the hypertension associated with the adrenal addisonian crisis, of course.
As a pre-renal, yeah.
Pre-renal, of course, most.
Yes.
In addition to cardiac depression from corticoid deficiency, affects the heart.
Yes. Also, the first case, many colleagues asked the symptoms of adrenal insufficiency. Generally, it is very difficult to diagnose in a patient in ICU because it is very vague.
As an intensivist, always when we find our patient in sepsis or critical illness and not responding, his blood pressure refractory to vasopressors and other monitor, we have to start routinely steroid.
So we have one diagnostic tool?
We take sample before giving steroid. Better to take sample and make a steroid level how much.
Okay. Also one question about the first case. The echo is normal. But Prof. Elansary, you said the myocardial dysfunction is one of the very important manifestation. So how can we suspect this one and the echo is known?
In the first case, there is some problem with the heart. The cardiac ejection fraction was low, I told, I think 25, and improved after replacement with steroid. Improved after treatment with steroid.
Okay. One question more about CVB is 11, but still patient hypovolemic.
this patient don't exhibiting hypovolemia. You know? We give steroids, but this patient, the hypotension not due to hypovolemia. We exclude the hypovolemia as a cause of hypotension from CVV estimation, which is 11. So not underlying cause for hypotension.
Yes, Prof.
I stress on this point. I highlight this point. I told this patient hypotension not due to hypovolemia, because CVB is 11. And so we start with fluid intravenous fluid resuscitations, but the patient hypotensive not due to hypovolemia, because this patient CVB was 11 centimeters. Of course, we depend on other parameters for evaluating the intravascular volume. The most important is IVC changes.
Yes, Prof. Also, in Fredrickson syndrome, how can we know that this patient need only hydrocortisone replacement or also need fludrocortisone as a
patient? If the patient is resistant to hypertension, we can give fludrocortisone.
Yes. So it's a clinical one.
Suffering from hyponatremia, we can give.
Yes, Prof. I don't know.
One more question, a straightforward question. Would you, doctor, prefer to stop levothyroxine in your patient?
I would prefer to stop?
Stop levothyroxine.
Why? He's suffering from hypothyroidism. We increase the thyroxine.
Okay.
Increase the thyroxine. In the case, we increase the thyroxine to...
Okay, perfect.
I think one last question, Prof. Elansary. Shireen, what is the link between systemic lupus and adrenal insufficiency?
What
is the link between, in second case, what is the link between systemic lupus and adrenal insufficiency?
Both autoimmune.
Only association.
And the other point in the second case, due to vasculitis, the patient suffering from hemorrhage may be due to high NR from warfarin or from vasculitis, which is associated with antiphospholipid syndrome. But mostly maybe from warfare and overload.
So, Dr. Afa, do you have more questions?
There is one question. Is it better to induce general anesthesia in severe sepsis cases with a combination of benzodiazepine and opioid rather than etomidate because it can cause adrenal insufficiency?
In Addisonian? Yes, etomidate itself causes adrenal deficiency. Etomidate itself, one of the main side effects is adrenal deficiency.
So I think it's better to avoid as the induction agent for anesthesia.
As induction agent, other than etomidate.
In case of severe sepsis.
Better, yes.
Yes, okay, thank you.
So
by that, I conclude our question. I think we accommodate all the questions.
We finish all. Right? Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Prof. As usual, excellent and very illustrative, very concentrated lecture. Thank you, Prof. Elansary, one of the figures and eminent name on critical care medicine. Thank you, Prof.
Thank you, Dr. Mohammed. Thank you, Dr. Afa. Thank you. I'm really happy with seeing you today. And my wishes to Dr. Isam. I saw Dr. Isam in front of me.
Okay.
I will stop here now.
Prof, I'm sorry. Missing you so much, wallahi.
Yeah, I'm missing you really.
How are you doing, sir?
Yes, thank you.